Is it working? Always the same issues. Just like last time, YouTube decided to move around everything and make stuff more... Oh, change stuff. This is just a change. It looks like we're on air. Hello. So just give me a second to readjust the things here. And hey, people, Retrobotor, Arc Wayfinder, Heartbeats, is it Univa? Awesome, thanks for coming by. This was a little bit of a hurry right now. Can you hear me? Can anyone verify that the sound is okay? And by the way, this time I'm doing water without gas, I learned. Yeah. Good evening. I knew it. Niva, hi. So, let's talk about finishing a track or finishing anything. This is a really tricky question. And the reason why I'm doing this live is... I need a gold teeth. So, reason I'm doing this live, I tried to record a video about this yesterday morning, and eventually I was running around the flat and thinking about stuff, and oh Jesus Christ, it didn't work. And then I eventually figured out I need to do this live, and in a way that's also what I want to address in this stream right now, like things and how you can figure out them, what to do next, what are the steps you have to do, what's missing, and all that to eventually help you overcome this I'm stuck in a loop or I can't finish my tracks anymore, what's going on. So bear with me as I'm trying to untangle this grandeur thing. And yeah, where should I start? Maybe it makes sense because my channel doesn't have an introduction right now. Since confidence is also a topic I'm going to address, what gives me the confidence to talk about this? And fair question. By the way, when I'm looking there, I'm checking the chat. So I've been making music for around 30 years right now, and not just music, also photography, dealing with computers. I worked as a sound designer, as a designer. I made two net labels and helped setting up another one and released a ton of music and games and took part in the development of audio products. And in the end, I'm looking back on right now around, I started counting this tangible thing, it's a number of around 250 to 300 music releases, project, demo scene stuff, that's creative art endeavor I'm very active in. And I learned a number of things because I'm also an autodidact and an introvert and I love thinking about stuff. And eventually, someday, I figured out it's all the same. You sit down, you want to create something, you get stuck and end up in this messy situation. And the way I very often found myself carving a way out of that is by following steps and be critical with myself and think about the situation, how I ended up there and what it really needs to move past it. And that's what I want to share, really. And just to make sure I'm eating my own dog food, I'm new to this streaming thing. I'm not confident about this, totally not. So I need practice to get better, right? And the only thing to get practice is actually doing this, which is what I'm doing right now. And I prepared myself to the best of my abilities. I sat down and wrote a list, which is right here. So I'm trying to not make this up. I also cleaned up my fucking table because I don't want distractions around here. I silenced my mobile phone to not get interrupted. I talked to my son so he doesn't enter the room. And I also don't expect this to be perfect or the answer to everything. And as a last bonus, I set myself a success criterion, which is if I get one person to get something out of this, I'm happy. And by the way, I'm talking about this, you already get an idea that this is not about a list of steps. You can simply make a check and then you get out of being stuck in the loop. At least I hope so. Yeah, let me check for the sound again. I have the impression that it's a little bit too loud, my voice. Can anyone in the chat verify that? I was getting some clipping, but maybe the CPU is also a little bit struggling. And am I still online? Yeah, this is never going to be a gold tooth, by the way. Sorry, it won't work. Well, that's a different topic. So, sound is good. Then, why is it so hard for me to answer this as ace? Sounds good. Kinda ASMR-like, yeah, I think this microphone is very sensible, so maybe one day I will sit down here and just do that. No. So, let's start with a spoiler for everyone watching who is new to music production. Maybe, and this is probably boring for the people who are watching right now, but music production is really a decathlon of things. You have to program your own sounds. You make beats, you have to find the right keys that translate your mood. You have to mix it and deal with tons of issues. It's about creating a sense of space and dealing with thousands of parameters. Would be interesting to have some kind of stats for a project. I would roughly guess that the average project I've got online, I've got working, has around 10 to at least 20,000 parameters. So paradox of choice, a huge topic. Especially for bedroom producers like us, we have to find and make time and find space. We have to deal with frustration when things don't work the way we want them to work, right? And you also have to commit to a result, and all these things are so intertwined, and the list isn't really complete, that getting stuck somewhere is such a complex situation, which very often doesn't have that much to do with music production, that I possibly can't give you a simple answer to that. And I also dislike the idea of giving a simple answer to that, because music production isn't simple. Creative pursuits aren't simple. It always looks simple when we watch stuff on YouTube and see all these people just doing things in 5 minutes or 2 hours like me. But what you don't see is the 30 years of experience I bring to this. So this enables me to sit down and twist some knobs and make it look like nothing, but it's really the culmination of effort I put into this, into learning that. And yeah, That's what this stream is really about. What I can answer is the question what it takes for me to get from a loop to a finished track. So, and for one, I need to be confident that the material I have is interesting. I have to trust my workflow. I don't want to think too much about what I'm doing. I'm a live jamming person, and if I'm not confident that I know what I'm doing, I cannot move past the loop. Or I have to sit down and paint the arrangement thing, which I also do sometimes depending on the project. But especially since this is somehow existing in a dub techno context, that's where I think live recording is the way to go. What else do I need? An uninterrupted frame of time, or a time box that's long enough. No open to-dos that need clearance of any kind. If I have to do the taxes and I have to send them in next week and I just don't feel prepared to do that, I don't know which steps and measures I have to take to get it done, it will always be in the back of my head and distract me. And all these tiny things, shit, this is totally weird to expect to sit down and make great music or just do anything creative if you have a list of things in your head that say, hello, look at me, right? I also need a halfway clean environment. If this was a complete mess, no, couldn't concentrate. Yeah, put the taxes next to me to, hello, you need to finish me? Yeah, sure thing. Great idea to not finish any music. And there is also stuff like, I shouldn't have had just an argument before trying to make music. That really fucks with my mood. And no, don't want that. I don't want that. And anyone in the chat has stuff to offer about that? And the list could go on, but there is so much outside the actual process of being creative. If you don't manage that, it might be a very good reason to get stuck in a loop and not be able to finish anything, really. So work on the conditions, really, for when you're trying to make music. That's really important. And the fuck, this smartphone thing, throw it out of the room. I put it in flight mode just for the sake, because it's my clock right now. But really, get rid of that. It especially if you are uploading your tracks to SoundCloud, or just have posted a photo on Instagram, or are active and entangled in some weird political discussion on Facebook. I personally find these are sitting in the back of my head as well all the time, and I cannot focus. And that's also one potential thing that we are going to talk about here. I hope this makes sense in a way, but maybe you get the idea why I can't answer this question too easily, and why I don't want to add to the folks of people who make this so simple as just like a life book. Buy a book about making a book. By the way, talking about books, Ableton has a good book which is stuffed with strategies. Time boxing, for example, is also one of them. It's a very good point of ideas and just things to put in your head that you can resort to. There was something when I'm getting into this situation that I can go to and read and try. So at best, after watching this, you at least have a better idea what might interfere with your process and how you can find a solution or where. That would be really super awesome if I managed to do that. So Hello, Mike. Sorry I'm late. You said 8 p.m., but clearly not UK time. Yeah, I just posted it on Twitter. I really suck with time zones. I think this is CET, but it isn't. I guess it's Greenwich Mean Time. Sorry. It's not too late. And it's on YouTube later on. And I think for now I'm happy with what I said so far. So you'll be able to catch up with what you've missed. Let's talk about some recipes for disaster first. I like Reddit. It's nice, and you have all these subreddits which are about music production. And yesterday I saw a thread about a person who just bought Ableton and then figured out it's not like GarageBand, and why is it so complicated and why does it look dull and boring. And in a way, it's like being a person who wants a bike, buys a Tesla, and then figures out, I don't have a driver's license, right? Maybe there's something off with expectations. And that's also something I would like to talk about later on. So, recipe for disaster number one, you have the idea about making music and think it's super easy, start doing it and become frustrated because you're finding out it's not simple and everybody makes it look simple. So be assured, it's not simple. I get stuck in the loop as well, and there are days at which nothing works. So it's not really that you're incompetent. Maybe you just know too little. Or maybe a certain piece of information is missing, and yeah, find it. It's not too easy. So, another recipe for disaster I see online all the time is people throwing a compressor on everything and they don't even know how levels work. I don't even know exactly how levels work. If I had to sit down right now and do the math when this shitty logarithmic thing is exactly twice as loud, no, I would probably end up talking crap. So, trying to apply the right tool to the right problem is a very good idea, and throwing a compressor on everything because people say so is very often not the best idea, unless you know what you're doing. Another recipe for disaster is you're stuck in a loop and you try to force yourself out of it. I think that getting out of such a situation needs a lot of ease and easygoing and being aware of what you can do and being aware of the situation and not just trying to function in a way. Who taught you that? Don't try to function in a situation where functioning is your worst enemy. Another recipe for disaster to me is having had an argument with my partner and then sitting down to try and record something. It probably won't work for me. Maybe it does for you. I heard there are a lot of people who can use that fuel to bang out stuff quickly. I can't. And I have the impression that a lot of people, from talking to many artists and creative folks over the years, that there is a certain kind of sensibility going, at least, or especially with people into this minimalist thing. So, yeah, so much about setting yourself up for disaster. Hey, Linus! Old face distortion, folks. Awesome. Hi. So, now that we have kind of established where this is going, then let's think about a little bit about the conditions under which music making or any creative effort can be allowed. And obviously, important factor number one is time. Did you set up yourself a frame of time to really focus on making music? Or are you distracted by other topics? What can you do then to get rid of these distractions? Does your space allow yourself to focus on what you're doing? Or is it a mess? Maybe you need a mess. That's okay. I sometimes need a mess too, in a way. What was your day like in general? How does that interfere? Are you in the mood for making music? That was a huge topic for me already, having this yearning itch to make music and then coming home from work thinking, okay, right now I have 2 hours spare time I can use, then I have to get my son to bed. But that created so much pressure around this precious piece of time that I wasn't free to do anything anymore. I should have sat down somewhere in a corner and watched my carpet. Would very often have been a better idea. So expectations are also a very, very important thing. And when we're talking about expectations, are your expectations also realistic to what you're trying to achieve? That's also a very good point. If I start making music and I have the expectations I want to sound like XYZ right now, that's also a very good way to end up really frustrated very, very quickly. So do I know enough to achieve the goal I'm trying to achieve? And that, especially the last one, requires a little bit of self-criticism and being honest with yourself, especially being honest with what you know, you know. And let's be honest, I started music as well, and I was new to this computery thing, and boy, did I think I had it all. Like, you're super smart as I can make this sound like this. I'm so much clever, but use a compressor everywhere. Yeah, no, eventually that didn't really get me to satisfying results. Instead, I created a ton of overcompressed music with a lot of good ideas, but a really messed up sound and projects in a software I cannot access these days anymore. It's all gone. It's been a waste of time, and that's what I see a lot, especially if you're young men. Give yourself a rest. Why do you expect yourself to know everything quicker than anyone else? Please don't do that with yourself. This is not good, not good. So let me check the chat real quick. Everything okay with you guys? Does it make any sense? It's very quiet in here, which makes me a little bit... Does anyone of you have a nice disaster story to share? I'm sure you have them. I mean, why not? It's human. And we all get stuck in a loop. By the way, this is, if you think about it, being stuck with a loop in music production and being stuck with that situation over time is a nice metaphor, isn't it? So then, what can we do really? And I think being aware of what's going on in some areas is very important. And the first area then is focus, the ability to focus. Like, you get it, is do you have clean space? What's going on in your mind? Pressing to-dos left. Could anyone interfere with me now? Could the telephone ring? Do I have to do anything? These are all focus-related topics, and I think being focused on what you do is super important to find the right questions when we get stuck in a situation when we don't have an answer. Because at first we need a good question, like, what the fuck is going on? What do I need to know that I'm not aware that I need to know right now? That's, like I said, music production is a fucking decathlon, and if you're stuck with mixing your track and things aren't working, then how could you really move that area forward? And that demands focus and attention to find the issue. And I know how hard this is to find the right answer if you don't even know what your issue is. And that's why I like to ask stupid questions and also allow stupid questions. I really mean it. If you have a question on one of my videos, write it into the comments. There is no stupid questions. I'm not going to trick you like an idiot. And if anyone else does, fuck 'em. It's not a shame to not know anything. It's a shame to waste time not knowing what the fuck is going on. So, but if you ask a question here, please come back and see if you've got an answer. Otherwise, it's my waste of time. And it's also very nice to let me know you've read something. And it's generally nice to let people know that if you have asked a question somewhere in forums in general on the internet or in real life as well. It's like, hey, saying thank you. It's a very nice thing. It's also the bridge to being able to ask a question again, right? So, and checking the chat. Retroboto, it's a lot about experience. That's why it's hard for me explaining to someone why are you using this and that parameter right now. Yes, it's entangled. It's a dynamic process. This music thing is, you turn a knob there and depending on how things are set up, they might do this or that. Sometimes an EQ cut may actually do an unexpected things, and you cannot simply take this piece of puzzle out and stick it into your own one. It's a different picture then. It's not going to work. Yeah, exactly. Disasters are just the opportunities. I wish I really had that approach. Thank you, Stefan. True. I think that every disaster is an opportunity to change something. And the most idiotic thing is to attend the same situation with the same set of skills and the same approach and expect a different result, right? Mike, I find it hard to get the balance between being self-critical and perfectionism, yes, and accepting mistakes and failure as part of growing and being creative, as if everything I record has to be 10-10. Yeah, let's talk about the expectation thing for a moment. That's a really good one, which is, I'm sorry, also on my list. And I find it hard too, yes, and I know there are a few people here who have the same struggles, and that's, I think, the human condition, especially when we start spending a lot of time or donating a lot of time to something. We have this weird thing going on that we should get better, right? And at some point we should be able to reinvent the wheel. And since you mentioned self-criticism, I think there are at least two kinds of that. There is, for one, the negative self-criticism, or the perfectionism, the expectations we have that we sit down now and this should be perfect. But then there is also the inquiry one that allows to reflect the situation. And I'm gonna share with you now something really stupid, and it's stupid. Ah, look who's there. Hello, bleep. I sat down one day and questioned my perfectionist voice, and I made a little scribble which is now hanging in Coco's flat, which, by the way, hello. And he's called Asshole. And I started having conversations with Asshole, really. Just to get in touch. And somehow I managed to make him grab a coffee and grant me a period of time to sit down for something like an hour or 90 minutes at first, and just let me do something. And then I ask him for his opinion. That sounds super stupid maybe, but it worked. For me it worked. To really grab this thing, this voice. We have these voices. It's just part of the human condition, right? And there are probably very good reasons why certain people are perfectionists, or more on the scale of perfectionism than other ones. And I guess it has a lot to do with the way we've been raised, and role models and all that stuff. And yeah, it makes sense to take some time with however you perceive that voice thing, whatever you want to name it, and find a way to deal with that. Maybe the idea of treating it like an unwilling dog is helpful. Quick check. Yeah, Ark backs it up. Perfectionist as well. I think you have to fall in love with the process and not the final end result. Oh yes, that's a very good one. And it's also part of expectations, like, do I sit down and expect myself to create a result, or do I sit down to have a good time? Let me check my things. And another thing that falls into the expectation category is being in competition with oneself. When I started uploading tracks to SoundCloud, I was constantly checking how many plays this or that had. And I also check how many views on YouTube I have right now, but I'm checking with much more ease. It's not important to me anymore. Like I said, if I get one person to find something in this stream that's valuable, that's really how I think about having had a good time. And yeah, being easy with yourself and not too results oriented is also a very, very, very important and crucial point, I think, unless you want to be rich and famous in like a month or so. But being in competition with oneself, trying to make a track that attracts more plays on SoundCloud than the last one. It just happens. It's also part of the human condition, I think, that we have to jump over our bar every time. And I guess part of the solution is becoming aware of that as well, and is in general being aware of stuff is half the solution already. Just the fact that we are here and talk about this stuff, I think, or like to think, that's half of what gets us further. Looking into the future, thinking about where you want to end up, is exhausting and damaging to the process. Yes, it can be. I think there are people to which that can be very helpful. And there are conditions in which I'm working towards a process or a result that keeps me going as well, but I think I have to start over this again. When I'm making music for a demo, that is one of these softwares that we develop just for the sake of fun. When I'm committing to one of these projects that is a combination of visual code and music, I'm in the boat with others. So I'm committing myself to deliver a piece of work, and in the end there is a result and we have a deadline to which it has to be finished, otherwise it just won't be released. And usually this event is a demo party with up to 1,000 people, and people are then gathering in front of a huge screen and show each other what they have produced during the last months or year. And the result then is I get to share my work in a setting which generates instant feedback. And so I wouldn't say necessarily that generally being focused on the result while producing something is bad. It depends on the setting, I guess. So, let me check. This looks interesting. So, that's actually what is often taught in martial arts. Don't be frustrated about what you don't know. The more you know, the less is your possibility to act freely out of your trained patterns. Yeah. True. Sasha says, I always struggle when I try to compose and mix at the same time. Things usually work out better for me when I strictly separate the two disciplines and either focus on one or the other. Yes. And that in itself is focus. So in order to really focus on a topic, you have to first focus on the puzzle and then on the area on which you're trying to work. Like I said, music production, decathlon, there is so much, and you will see that you have seen this in my videos already, and you will surely see this in the future again. When I'm entangled in tweaking knobs and parameters, I just lose sight of levels and sound. Then other things are more important. And it takes focus to readjust, to step back. It needs focus to step out of the focus, one step back on the bigger picture and see in which area am I right now, where did I end up, and which other areas need some work in a way. A lot of interesting stuff in the chat. I like the saying, tend to the part of the garden you can reach. Work on the things that are closest instead of trying to reach an end goal. Yeah, same. So, let me get back. So focus, expectations. Another thing that's super important is confidence. If someone is starting to make or learn anything, like me right now trying to get better at streaming, I cannot be confident at this unless I'm a psychopath, right? If I thought I'm super good at this without ever having done it, there would be something wrong in my book. So I lack the confidence, and it gets better as I'm doing it, and that's fine. But if you're starting to make music or try something entirely new, you cannot be confident, and it's very important to have a certain kind of confidence to move on. So do I know enough to get this loop into a track? Do I have the confidence to finish something, or am I afraid of producing a result? That's also a good one. Am I confident that this, what I'm doing right now, is interesting at all? I think that the only way to find out if something is interesting and developing confidence in it is being able to listen to what you have for hours. That's my way of reassuring me this is a good loop, for example. And also having the confidence of trusting that judgment. There's something I forgot to mention earlier, and we have this brain thing, and that's a very good change detector. It's amazing at detecting even subtle changes. Maybe you know that you came home one day and your wife or girlfriend just changed a detail in the entrance area, maybe just new bulb, and it's slightly, it has a different kind of white, and you walk in and something has changed, but you don't know what it is. And every time you go past that, it's, what has changed? I don't know. And eventually, a year later, the bulb is shred and you change it and figure out, oh, it's different than the one before. That's what really changed. So we are really good at detecting change. The problem with computers is they reproduce the same thing sample by sample. If we don't tell them not to do that, if I just sit down and you put in a kick and it will sound the same always. It just sounds the same. And if you use a certain set of synths and stuff, it will just be the same repeating thing sample by sample for an hour. And if you're in that situation, no matter how great the composition is, well, maybe the composition is so good that this continuous sample by sample replication doesn't matter that much. But especially with not that melodic dub techno thing, I find that loops are getting boring super fast if it's really down to the sample, exactly the same thing over time. And no matter how much time we spend, at a certain point brain says, ugh, boring, not interesting. And what helps is understanding how VSTs work that try to emulate analog nonlinear behavior, or what I'm trying to convey in my other videos until now is how to create movement that isn't exactly the same, that keeps evolving over time. To me, that's a very good way, and it's reassuring because I can look at the screen and check the amount of things that are moving over time and verify that with my ear. Is this interesting to grow this confidence? Yes, it's interesting, apart from experience. Maybe if you're more new to this, it's also a good way to grow into this confidence thing, knowing that the loop is good material to take it into a track. Confidence, important. A lot of stuff is happening here. Wow. I start losing track. By the way, this is still dub techno related. Focus, confidence, expectations. Another thing, commitment. Looking at a screen of parameters in music production is the very paradox of choice in itself. There is so much that twist me, please. You can change me, or no, change me and change me. You need to really be confident to commit to what you have right there and let go. This is it. You have made the decision that brought you here. I'm confident this is... I made the decisions consciously. That also helps with confidence, not just fiddling around with somewhat and eventually ending up somewhere. That can be a happy coincidence somehow, but really being aware of what you're doing, it adds to the confidence that allows you to make a commitment to the sound you have created. And maybe it's a good idea to bounce a track into samples to prevent yourself from thinking about further edits. Also think about the time you spent to end up there, and if you ran into a ton of problems, don't ignore them. If something prevents you from committing to what you have, try to find out what it is. Does the kick not sound good? Is the way the bass and the kick interact not right? Try to solve it. Try to bring it down to a question and ask someone. Find a mentor. That's also good. Having someone you can ask stuff. And next thing that I find important to be able to commit to something is knowing where my bar for good enough is. So the perfectionist thing again. If I have just 90 minutes to make a track, and it happened already, it can happen anytime. With experience, it's much more likely to happen more than often. But really, do I want just to sit down, make a track, and then commit to a recording and that's it? Or do I want to produce something for weeks? And in such a context, committing can be much more daunting, yes. In my experience, the longer I'm working on something, the tougher it gets to commit to a result. And I really have to be careful with in the process to not fall into that trap of being stuck and unable to commit. And this only works again with being fucking aware of what I'm doing. It's like trying to assess the situation, the problems, and all that stuff. And yeah, so commitment, another important thing. Let's see. So I'm trying to catch up with the stream. Any questions? Borg Technologies. Hi Ronnie. Biggest thing holding me back finishing music is that I don't seem to be able to disconnect the finished track from my ultimate goal, which is playing out live. Yeah. Give yourself time, man. Who said you have to achieve this in any given frame of time? That's really the best thing I can tell you to that. Because, I mean, I don't know how long you have been making music and how much you depend on making money with music. Those are two very important factors in that. But yeah, it's tough. It's a really tough setup. Shitty conditions that create a lot of pressure, and I think to work under this circumstance needs resilience more than anything. Like, being a professional artist, it looks so nice and you get to tour a lot and all that stuff, but man, you have to deliver all the time. You have to deliver great sets, new tracks, releases, keep the flow going, and you're either very resilient and know how to deal with that situation because you have grown into it. There is no manual. It's not that anyone I know fell into that without making mistakes, ending up in ruts, having ear fatigue issues, stress, burnout, whatever. The stories are written all over it. I mean, depression in dance music is not a new thing, right? And that's where it comes from. Like, working under pressure and pressuring, putting yourself under too much pressure, that's fucking dangerous. And I think the best you can do is really try to give yourself time and let things slide a little bit, if that makes sense. I hope that's not too disappointing, and I wish I could tell you right now, do this and that. And I'm sure you will meet your ultimate goal, Borg Technologies, playing out live, if you keep making music, attend. Be consistent with your process, learn, hone your crafts, and put your music out and get in touch with people, and things will happen. But if that already right now interferes with the very act of making music, that's no good. Really, don't give up that ultimate goal, but give yourself time. You need time. It's the resource it needs. I hope this was somewhat helpful. I guess it was rather disappointing. Yeah, sorry. Ark says, it's difficult not to mix disciplines when doing creative work. I work in a machine shop and it's immediately obvious which work should be grouped together. Interesting. The same cannot be said for creative work. The work that is needed to be done is nebulous and not very well defined, if that makes any sense. Yes and no. I think that what I'm trying here is to give pointers how to structure all this and become more aware of all the things that are happening at once, and once you have developed a sense for all that's going on, you're able to really take things in the creative process apart and shift your attention back and forth. It's really a mindfulness topic to not step into the esoteric realm, but it can be done, and I think it's very helpful and important also to develop a sense for that, which is really what I'm trying to do here. Breaking down all the parts and the puzzle that is creative work, and to me I find it's the same in photography and drawing and writing. It's just that I'm not that good in these disciplines. I think that the thing I do best after music production and DJing is photography, probably. At least in terms of knowing what's going on and how this works. And we will get to that, because it's interesting how all these things are interconnected. So, Mike. Yes, indeed, spending too much time on details and not on the main elements, arrangement, and therefore losing momentum and inspiration. You have to keep that in mind. Especially under time constraints. Wayfinder says, the thing about rules is understanding them as a prerequisite for breaking them. Otherwise, you really just do what you want, and that happens to be against the rules. Yes, that's Karate Kid summed up. First learn, then recreate, then find a way to use the tools to carve your own thing. That's the way I understand it. Bitwix modulators are perfect for adding movement. Yes, and I'm looking forward to do a stream on Bitwix and how I'm making use of them as well sometime soon. Roman, I find that too, putting myself on a limited time scale, like a day to do a track, will make me much more likely to have something like a finished track in the end. Yes. Who said that every kind of work needs exactly the amount of time that's available? Coco, help. So, stream hiccups. Oh no! Is it working now? I hope it solved themselves. I'm also recording the stream. In worst case, I can upload it again. Parkinson's Law, yes. Thank you. Thank you. Emtronic, hey! That's you. Ronan. Sorry, I said Roman. Moving on. I've got some stuff left. So no, time boxing. We talked about time boxing already, and it makes perfect sense. If you are struggling to finish a track, that's what I'm also doing when I feel that I have spent too much time with a track, yet I'm liking it too much. I'm setting myself a time box of, for example, 60 minutes to fix the mix. Look at the mix. Is this a problem right now? Is the arrangement a problem? And split the process into time boxes and commit to having it done in like 3 time boxes of 60 to 90 minutes. And really analyzing everything from mix, arrangement, or elements that are present. And something pops up in my head right now. No, I need to think about it. Stream is still a little bit flaky. Okay. The only thing I can think of doing right now is switching from 1080p to 720 to mitigate the issue. And I'm not sure that's a good idea either. I'll keep an eye on that, if that's okay. So then, time box is also a form of limiting oneself. I find limitations awesome. Sasha just brought up the C64 thing. That's super limited to work with, and that's also the fun part. It's like you don't have all these options, but setting yourself a challenge can be really good in a situation where frustration has piled up. I came up with this thing I'm calling creator's debt. That's the situation when you are stockpiling unfinished projects on your hard disk and start something new every day. I think that's super frustrating. And what I've been stuck with that for a period of, I think, 3 years already. Bye, Neva. Thanks for joining. And the reason why I stuck was I switched from my DAW back then, Bus Tracker, to Ableton Live, and I didn't know the shortcuts. And things were just new, and I expected myself to get into that by magic hand. Just, ugh. And eventually, I didn't think about it, started a track, didn't finish anything, and then had a folder of unfinished projects. And eventually I figured out I just don't know Ableton well enough. I don't know how things work with getting from the loop to the arrangement in a way that worked for me. And my MIDI controller somehow didn't work. I think in the end I figured out I just had the override automation button disabled, and that was kind of my bottleneck. And it took me 3 years to figure that out, because I didn't pay attention. I could have figured it out earlier. I could have spared myself a lot of frustration. So all this stuff is also a note to self. So, do you know your shortcuts? Do you have a workflow already? If you're stuck in a loop on your new producer who can't look back on a situation in which things were easier, or are you a producer who maybe has a history with playing guitar, who now tries to make electronic music and things don't work and get stuck in the loop. That's also important to take into consideration, because we have these expectations. I started making music in a hardware studio with a friend, Hazeren, and that was during the early 90s, and most of the tracks, I mean, there was an Atari with Notator, I guess, and all the hardware stuff, Roland, you know what, and a nice mixer, and it just let, if we wanted to arrange a track, it was just muting channels, and we really went for the wild pitch approach of recording stuff live, just hit record and jam on it, do it, not that much of fancy arrangement. And then he started like, oh, we have to arrange our tracks, and I was like, no, let's just jam, it's much more fun. And really, in the situation when I was stuck after moving from Bus to Ableton, what helped was incorporating the MIDI controller in a way that made Ableton very accessible to me, that emulated the way I learned making music, and that provides so much more freedom to be able to jam down quickly. And by the way, I don't find, I have an APC 40 sitting here. That's a fucking nightmare. I don't know what you guys did wrong, but it's wrong. At least for me, it doesn't help at all. I find the abstract parameter jumping untamable. I haven't found the switch where I can say, just keep the knob where it's at. I don't know how this works. Maybe I'm lazy. Yes, it's a good chance I'm lazy. And probably that works. But it's just confusing. I like a distinct position in a room where I know I put the cutoff of the filter there, here. I don't have to think about that, and I don't want to switch channel and then have this gone, and where is the button to jump back to that channel? So maybe you have a MIDI controller that's an autopilot, and there's a way for you to make this work better. Maybe you have the same issue, that you are more the person who likes a distinct position of a fader in a room and cannot fiddle around with the switching parameter changes, then try to find a way to solve it. Whatever makes working with music more spontaneous is good. And it's not a shame to not be able to relocate positions in mind. I mean, recording a track with 10 parameters, and especially that's important to me in the dub techno context, is to be able to know here is reverb send, there is a filter, mutes. I just want to be able to record this thing live, and there is something about recording live in terms of timing and how things develop. I find it super hard to draw that with clips around. Moving clips around on the screen to me is a nightmare. Bitwig helped a lot because it somehow made some of the connections less abstract. And yet there I'm also, when I'm doing the techno, dub techno thing, the live recording stuff. And that's really helpful. If you don't have a MIDI controller, get one. That's the actionable step I can really suggest. If you're stuck with making loops, try to make your setup more accessible to instant spontaneous change. Does it make sense? So, Mike asks, do you mainly use Ableton, since I haven't seen you use too many third-party ones? I feel I should explore Ableton devices more. When I'm using Ableton, very often I'm just using what Ableton has to offer in terms of synths. And for the last week I've been super happy with Wavetable because it's just mind-blowing. And I still don't think analog sounds that great, but it can be tamed a lot in whatever way. I have a few other VSTIs for certain applications, I think, but I mean, most of the time I'm interested in very basic sounds, and I don't need much synthesis features to create that. So why use anything else except for presets? I mean, very often a synth is, especially the amount of presets it comes with, and I get that. When I made music for games, I really relied on having a huge library of sounds I can use and know where they are. But when I sit down to make some dub techno stuff, I mean, it's very often just the same things, and the most important things are how filters are set up and stuff like that. It's not really a thing of the synth itself. And generally spending time and really diving deep into something is, I think, one of the best things you can do anyway. Knowing something inside out, even something as stupid as Ableton's analog, it has a lot of tricks, and trying to unwind them to create the sound you want is, I think, time well spent. Because if once you've got your head around how to set up a certain sound and how that translates to other synth... Sorry, am I hiding behind the microphone? Super valuable. I mean, most synthesizers share the same set of features anyway. And yes, there are distinct differences, like FM synths are totally different than subtractive ones, but how often do you really need to fiddle around with FM? And if you do and have wavetable, let's talk about that in the next video, which will be a little bit about wavetable. And I mean, it makes FM synthesis super easy. You just enable it, dial in a sign, and then crank up the amount of FM you want. If you want these PPG style keyboards, way to go. Got distracted. So, what have we been talking about? Recipes for disaster. The conditions under which to make music. Focus, confidence, expectations, commitment, time boxes. A little bit about self-criticism. Someone wrote in the comment on the last video that he thinks I'm a little bit too self-critical, and yes, I am. But to me, that's key to really keep in touch of what I'm doing and move forward. I want to be able to learn quickly and use my time efficiently, as efficiently as possible. And I think that doesn't work without a certain extent of the positive kind of self-criticism that keeps you in a healthy distance to what you're doing and the process you're entangled in. If that makes sense. Stream is very silent. Does it still work? Can anyone say, give me a live signal? to. I still have... Okay, I'm fine. Phew, good. Yeah, ping. So then... And this is where it gets really interesting. And... That takes me way beyond my comfort zone. Let's talk about art. And minimalist art in general. A lot of things that I've been talking about to me refer to a way of spending time. A way to be focused, a way to put distractions away. Paying attention, which I think is a very good pointer. And the way I think about it right now, art, and I'm really trying, I don't do this because I want to make money. To me, this is about making art, if that's not clear. I'm sitting here because I want to help people make art and get out of their own way as good as I can. So, and to me, art, in a way, is a way of messing with time. When I put out a piece of music and somebody's listening to it, I have the attention of someone. When I, someone who paints a picture and it's and puts it into a museum and invites people to look at it, they spend their time to the artist, in a way. And if you think about that, art is also a way of spending time, the creation of art. I think there is a direct correlation between the amount and quality of time and care and thought that somebody put into making something that correlates with the result. And that's where we get to talk about Josef Beuys. Do you know Josef Beuys? You will love that. In case you didn't, he was an artist, a German artist, from 1921 to 80 something, and he became most famous for taking a piece of butter, throwing it into a corner and declaring it art. And then, this is him, and he, I'm not making this up. Josef Beuys took butter, put it into a corner, and that was his art piece. And then, a Reinigungsfachkraft, someone cleaned it up and got sued because it wasn't depictable for the person that this was a piece of art. And there have been a lot of discussions whether that's art or crap, and I don't want to judge that. But I would say that the it takes experience, time, and the ability to go into a creative place, to come up with that idea, commit to it, and do it. And whether that's art for you or not, I'm leaving that to you. It is a very good question that he put there by stacking a shit ton of butter in a corner. So, funny story, and this is also a very good, it's a very interesting, there is a documentary about him, and you should see it, it's really good. He also said something very good, I think, and if it still holds up until today. He said, each one of us has the creative potential which is hidden by competitiveness and success aggression. Now think about SoundCloud plays and everything we talked about. So someone who's saying that he definitely had an understanding for art, I guess, in my book. And it's also a very minimalist thing to do, to take butter and throw it into a corner and be confident. Confident. We also talked about confident. Confidence. Be confident. Yeah, that's my piece of art. Something to consider the next time when you're sitting there stuck with a loop. Maybe that's just a piece of butter. Why not? Maybe it's good. Why not? I also have to ask myself that all the time. So, now, expanding the idea that art is a way of spending time and distance and all that is brings me to is it Andreas Gursky? Yeah, art, not Artemo, yeah. But let's talk about something that can be easier. So understood and credited for being art. Rhine 2 by Andreas Gursky. I had to think about that when I watched Moritz von Oswald's Red Bull lecture, which you should watch too, strongly recommend that. Where he talks about his approach to dub technique and music and finding calm moments and this kind of distance to what you do. And I had to think about Gursky's Rhine picture, which is the most expensive photo ever sold, I think, for £2.7 million. And there was an article somewhere where he described the process, how he made this photo. And obviously this is edited, and he removed every distraction from the image to come up here. Removing distractions. That's a nice metaphor. You can remove distractions from your process to remove distractions in your music. And I think that's also somehow tied up and interferes with the process and the result. I find this to be one of the calmest images. It's almost like this. To me, these two things are the same. Not that I would say the patch that's playing in the background right now is worth £2.7 million, but the quality, the calmness, the distance, the space, I guess he looked at that one very long, again, again, and again, before coming to the conclusion and committing to the final result. Maybe he didn't. I wish I could ask him. But I think there is something about the process of creating this minimalist stuff that is common and true for music as well as photography and anything really. I guess that you cannot make something like dub techno or minimalist art with a hectic mindset. It really needs some kind of calm space and calm situation and reflecting about what you do, and to really create this horizontal kind of thing that keeps the interest up over 5 to 15 minutes without getting annoying and without being too boring. And that's to me a very small area to work in. And I find that very interesting. That's what I find most interesting about dub techno and drone music and ambient and all that stuff. So, Sasha says, there is hardly a way to really define art. Boy's butter installation is artificial, provokes a discussion, evokes questions. Personally, I do consider it as art. Yes, and that's why I've been thinking about this, that art is a way of spending time, and that it's much about paying attention to what you do. It's like as if attention has a value. Being in the moment and present and asking yourself, what's missing from this track? What can I add? All this adds up to a certain kind of mindset, an approach towards making something that eventually then can become art. And to me, that's really what art is about. It's a way of paying attention to what you do and using the time exclusively for this doing. And craftsmanship I think every activity that is carried out with attention and care is art. Hi Shana, my goodness, I've been baffled by the last video already. Since when do you sound like the most amazing Buddhist monk in the middle of meditation ever? Do I? Someone told me I sound like Bob Ross of music production already. Well, bring it on. I'm fine. I'm trying to keep this bullshit free. I'm trying to be relatable and puzzle it and stitch it together in a way that's accessible and that people can find a better way to take action in getting rid of their issues. I mean, we are talking about how to finish a track, and I think all this relates perfectly to how to finish a track. You don't think about what you're doing, you don't finish a track. You have a mix issue and you don't know what it is, you don't finish the track because something in your head or stomach says, well, it sucks. And all I'm trying to build up here is some kind of context to draw this or that out from, because I think whoever is sitting and watching this, I hope. And if you are watching this tomorrow or whenever, because I keep the stream online, if you're watching this video and there is a point that somehow resonated with you, and maybe I should clean up my desk, or maybe I shouldn't try to make music after being yelled up every day by anyway, please let me know. And maybe this is utter bullshit, I don't know. If it is, let me know as well. I can take it. Because that's another thing. I think if you are too focused on a result, you are also too focused on getting fucks or no fucks by other people. It's like getting a lot of plays and a lot of comments. And I think that's really sad. And connecting with why you sit down and want to produce music is vitally important to keep you moving forward. That's like a super, like the energy battery, the Vata battery of your process is why you want to do this. So think about that. And no, probably it took me about 40 years to develop an idea why the heck I'm making music. So I don't expect you to find an answer too easily, but keep this, put it in the back of your head, and it will be useful someday, for sure. Promise. So for one, how late is it? 90 minutes. I thought this would take longer to explore. Yeah. Any questions? Says about that picture, there is no intrinsic value in that photo or a simple dub cord that warrants millions of dollars in value. To me it isn't. You're right, but there seems to be an commercial art world out there who's interested in turning anything into millions of dollars value. And in the music world, that's probably stuff like Tomorrowland, right? Mike says, in fact, that's another point, the mixture of art and science when writing a track, trying not to fall into the muscle memory trap. That's interesting. You mean repeating steps over and over again just for the sake of repeating them and not thinking about them? I think that could be mitigated by paying attention to what you're doing as well. And I'm totally prone to doing the same thing over and over again. I mean, I'm not particularly known for reinventing the wheel either. And it's good to have, in a way, it's good to have, if we're talking about muscle memory and things that we do automatically, it's good to have these tools, in a way. Maybe the idea, if it gets too repetitive every time, to step out of that or just take a step back and watch oneself repeating these steps and then consciously doing something different next time. And yeah, maybe that's also one thing I can add in the end. I love to experiment. This is an experiment to me, again. I love to experiment with notes. And sometimes use combinations of notes that seem dull and ugly at first, and see if I can find a way to make it sound more, I'm sorry, interesting. No gas in the water. And Yeah, when I'm starting a sound design, I'm very often opting for saw waveform. It's like my go-to. And it's interesting to consciously not do that. And try to use effects in a way that you haven't used them, like disable LFOs on phasers is cool to color up a sound. Wait. Even if you're trying to experiment, be creative, but find that everything sounds the same. One thing I find hard is being in control of the tools, e.g. DAWs, this synth plugins, and not let them control me. Yeah. That's interesting. So you have the impression they are controlling you, if I understand that correctly. I'm thinking about that. Mike, I would suggest you to try to make a style of music you haven't made before. Maybe that's drum and bass or something that's way out of line with what you usually do, and see, because that's an area that's novel soil, and then you can really see which kind of stuff you just do automatically and where you have to struggle, because I guess that making something for the first time and fucking up an aim and break can be super funny. I don't do that often. If you haven't done that, could be interesting to draw something out of that. Really try. I wish I would be able to play the guitar and sit down playing the guitar with just an echo pedal for an hour or a day and see what I could draw out of that. Same with a piano, like an instrument. I'm not very good with my MIDI keyboard. I can't do the timing well. It's something that has been on my bucket list forever, is learning piano, but I didn't prioritize that high enough yet. So, blaming myself. And yes, Stefan, that Doom video by Mick Gordon is insane. It's very good. And Mike, check out that video as well. And by the way, I sat down and recreated a similar setup with free VST stomp boxes, and it was a lot of fun. You can do that with free stuff, and Bitwig is probably much more suited for that, because it's more modular and flexible in a way. However, you can still do the same thing in Ableton as well. It would be fun experimenting and making a setup that explores this. So for those who haven't seen it yet, Mick Gordon is the guy who made the soundtrack for 2016's Doom, or Doom 3, I think, and in his talk he explored how he made most of the music with by feeding sine waves through an array of stomp boxes. Boy, that's a lot of color, that I can tell you. And it's good. It's a really good experiment. And also there is this new Zoya FX dump box synth thing. It's a small box. Yeah, anyway, look it up. Z-O-I-A. And they basically put a modular system into the size of this small stomp box. And it's really accessible, and you can do a lot of shit with that. Maybe if you're into outboard gear and trying something different, or maybe you're playing the guitar, why not? I heard it's great, and I think I want one. And damn, Saoki, damn, I missed an hour. You posting this up on your channel afterwards? Yes, I will. Stefan says yes, and point was that his goal was to create something completely different by trying to change his workflow, which he later started was a necessary condition to achieve it. Still talking about the McCordon thing. Yes, he really broke out of all his comfort zones and patterns in a situation that presented him with the struggle of coming up with the music for one of game history's most renowned titles. Kudos. That needs balls. So, confidence. There we have it again. That takes some. Yeah. I need. I wonder if I'm confident enough to watch a recap of this very stream myself. Could be the ultimate test. And no, I'd really like to add that yes, I spent a lot of time thinking about these things for various reasons, but I wouldn't recommend anything just to sound clever. I'm applying, or I'm trying to apply all these things myself, and in itself applying these things is the challenge. Even knowing these things sometimes doesn't help me mitigate an issue until I step back, find the distance, reevaluate the situation, and grab into this box of things and check out, am I lacking focus? Is this the time to make music? That's also something. Maybe sometimes we are stuck in a loop because it's just not the time in life to take the time for that. Maybe because you have young children or something like that. Best video game soundtrack of all time, Quake 1 soundtrack by Trent Reznor. Yeah. It's definitely up there, and I'm not into making best of lists. Oh, by the way, that brings me to another very exciting answer to the most asked question out there. What is the best XYZ for XYZ? And the top answer, and the one you don't want to hear, is the one you have. The best synth to sound like whatever is the one you have. And I guess that's kind of disappointing. But true. Very often. At least you want a 303. If you want a 303, the only thing you have to get is a 303, or spoiler, baseline, or a hardware replica of choice, because I'm totally not biased. Yeah, I've Wayfinder, I think there's an argument to be made for choosing your tools by interface, like OTB versus ITB. Oh Jesus Christ, do we really want to step into that area? It's super fantastically important, yes? Your tools by interface. What do you mean with interface? The UI or the accessibility? And I'd be interested in hearing your opinion, because until now I thought you were producing most of your music with hardware only. So can you share a little bit of your thoughts, please? Ah, yes, about the way you use them. Yeah, totally is. And the only thing I can get back to is getting some kind of hardware control, especially for music that is, that wants to be created with live interaction, like live mixing. That's really important. I mean, most of my life I've been making music with a keyboard on trackers, like Pro Tracker and Fast Tracker, and using a mouse, and it's limiting what the process limits the results. It definitely does. And in a way that was much more liberating because of lack of options. And I have this thing here, and it lacks a few modules. And to be honest, I haven't been using this in a track in 2 years. It's great fun. I can sit down in front of that and just make sounds and get lost in it, and it's much more a meditative process than one that yields results. I think I'm just someone who enjoys sitting in front of a screen with a very limited set of MIDI controls to get my juices going. But maybe I only miss a few important modules as well, because yeah, there is some stuff missing right now, and I'm overwhelmed by making the right choices, and my bank account says no either way. So yeah, Wayfinder says I don't use much hardware actually. I have a DJ controller and a MIDI keyboard, and that's basically it. Yes, but maybe, and you can probably back this up, there are certain virtual instruments which actually make me play and perform on the keyboard much more musical and better than most others. And I found that Reactor Steam Pipe is one of them. I can sit down and just go through the black key Chinese scale thing, and all of a sudden my timing works, which I find very odd. And Lounge Lizard, that ePiano Rhodes thingy, is another occasion that's just very well made. It responds well, and I think that there is a lot, there are lots of differences in the way virtual instruments react to MIDI controls and velocity in special. And I still haven't found out what the difference really is, but there are certainly things that you can do well, and I have the impression that the majority of the market doesn't do them too well right now. Which is interesting. It's also a question of interface and response. They just respond somehow very musical. Finder says, "What I do is make little racks in life with combinations of instruments I find useful for improvisation. Like I have a Schnauss machine." Ulrich Schnauss, of course. Yes. Oh yes, Sasha. Black Keys Chinese scale. Is it D sharp pentatonic? I don't speak chords and notes. I wish I did. I really don't. And it's embarrassing. It's really embarrassing. I would try to record a stream the other day to get into a wavetable, and once again I started with programming a chord, and I sat down and pressed some keys, and Jesus Christ, that's unbearable. Because what I really do when I want to create a complex sounding pad like this is holding notes and trying with one hand and trying to find matching notes that are interesting with the other, and then it gets complicated because at least I want 8 notes, so really move around, and it can take a few minutes, and it's probably super embarrassing and I can't show you that, but it's okay. In the end I have a set of a chord that's interesting to me, and I wouldn't do that. Yes, I do that with mouse right here, and it looks disgusting, but it's different. It's also interface. When I start programming notes into this piano roll, I found that most of the time I'm restricting myself on an area of roughly 2 octaves, just the amount of stuff that fits on the screen. But these huge rich pads and drones very often benefit from having a structure laid out across twice the octave range. That's also maybe an actionable tip I can give you if you are trying to make something like this pad. Go for, yeah, I mean right now I have 2 octaves as well, yeah. Use many octaves, more than I do right now. Just give it a try. Try different stuff. So it's close to 10 right now, and I think I've got everything shared that I wanted to share, and I will definitely keep on making videos and try to do this more quickly. And if you have questions, please ask them. Really, there is no stupid question. There is no stupid question. Put it into the comments, hit me up on Twitter, tell me what you think. This is my answer to the question, how do I make a track, or how do I finish a track, or how do I get unstuck out of a loop. And I guess when I'm going to bed tonight, there are lots of things popping up in my head I wish I had said but didn't. I will deliver them. Let's take this as a start of a conversation, right? And maybe I make up my mind about what art is really tomorrow or tonight, who knows. So let's keep in touch and watch out for further videos, and share it with your friends if you find it useful. And if you really find it useful, let me know. I mean, I'm making this to really help out someone, and I wish that someone is going to clean up his room and I wish someone else is trying to ban the smartphone from the studio space, or try to mitigate another issue, or develop a plan to get the fucking taxes done before trying to make music. So, with that said, thank you very much, everyone on the stream. It was a great pleasure. It went down much more easily than I expected. And yeah, take care. And see you soon. So, Camilo, you're welcome. Ronan as well. See you on the stream. Andrew, Wayfinder, Sasha, Coco, you're still there. Shana as well. Thanks for dropping by, taking your time. I mean, if I managed to steal a little bit of your precious time, that's pretty cool. And yeah, lovely music. So, see you around. Let's keep in touch and good night. Alex.